thank y'all for being here. All of you that are here will not get a nasty gram from me later on. We had 150 people sign up to be here today. But we're very excited for this opportunity today, and I want to thank everybody for taking the time. Columbia has really embraced, as long as I've lived in this community, has embraced small businesses, and it's so important. I mean, it really is the backbone of our community. And so we want to continue to highlight, be there to support through our OBO office. Ms. Driggers, will you raise your hand? The rest of the OBO staff, we all raise your hands. Everybody can see you. They do an incredible job helping small businesses, but we want to continue to bring resources to Columbia and make sure people understand what's available to them in our community, if it's state, local, or federal. But we're hosting these events, and hope to have a whole lot of other events like this one, really to make sure that we're getting out to all of our citizens. We've had an incredible run over the last 2 years of small businesses growing in our community. We've had more new applicants for business licenses than we've ever had. We've opened up more women-owned businesses. Ladies, give yourselves a hand. Which is incredible. But I had Alan, and I met in Washington. Alan Thomas is the regional, they call him director?
Administrator.
Administrator. It's even bigger than director, right? Administrator, but what's great about Alan being the regional administrator is he's a former mayor. So he actually understands what we're trying to do because he's been there as a mayor. He's dealt with the small business community. And I think this is what's interesting about some of the positions in the federal government right now is that we have a lot of former mayors that are there. And so having these conversations, if I'm talking to a secretary or talking to the regional administrator, they understand what we're trying to do as a community and are willing to help. And so we're excited to have Alan here. We have Ms. Vicki Evans here, who is a small business owner who's going to tell her story today. And I think y'all are going to be very impressed with what she has to say. And obviously, all the SBA, where's the SBA team? Can y'all raise your hands? I know some of you are outside. Greg White is right here. I met Greg when he was with the USDA. So he knows cross-utilization, so there you go, which is really great to how to work with the different agencies and figure out what are the pockets that can help your business. So we're going to talk about everything about what the SBA has to offer, how businesses are taking advantage of the programs they have, understanding what state, local, and federal resources are today, bridging the gap, not only from the process, but the resources. A lot of people think the process is too cumbersome, but at the end of the day, it's worth it. So how do we help you get through that? How do we use the other resources we have to prepare you for that? And then obviously, we want to continue to share information, as we said, not only through our local offices, but our ABO and our city resources. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Alan to talk a little bit about SBA.
Well, first of all, let's give the mayor a hand for bringing us together here today. And I want to give you a hand for running through the raindrops this morning. You know, the first thing people do when the meteorologist talks about rain, they find reasons to check things off the list, right? But that's the difference between people who succeed and people are always saying, I woulda, coulda, shoulda, right? Don't ever let anything get in your way of opportunity. And every day I get up and I'm excited, Mayor, about what I get a chance to do. Because I get to meet pieces of sunshine like this lady all over. So I am the regional administrator. I cover my territory and area that I have. There's a handful of us across the country. So I have from Kentucky through the Carolinas, Tennessee, Alabama, the Mississippi River, all the way to Florida, the entire Southeast, the SEC Conference. That's basically what I am, right? And as the mayor mentioned, I am a former mayor. I was a three-term mayor in Greenville, North Carolina. That's the bigger Greenville. We think a lot of time about that. East Carolina, the university's there. Big hospital center is there. And I've been an entrepreneur since I was 10 or 11 years old. I was on the hustle. coming up with ideas, and my family encouraged it. They encouraged a little bit of risk. I lost some allowances now and then, but I won a few too, right? But the opportunity to get ahead and what I know about being an entrepreneur, the great thing about the regional administrators, like in my role, many of us, there's 9 of us across the country, we come from the business community. We were appointed by the White House. We have phenomenal professionals that work with SBA across the whole country. Greg White and his team is amazing here in South Carolina. And boy, did I learn it during the PPP, right? During the pandemic. 2.5, 3 years ago, I was asked looking for a PPP loan. I was executive vice president with an aerospace and a plane, jet plane company. We had 480 employees. I didn't know if they'd have a job the next day. But what I learned from SBA started my journey to get back in this role and the opportunity to be an advocate and help spread the news. Many people, when they hear about all that SBA and some of these agencies bring to the table, they are blown away, aren't they, Vicki? People are like, well, why didn't I know about this before? Well, entrepreneurs by nature get in a silo because you're so focused on making things happen, your idea, your concept. You know, I got an amen group here in the front row, back row too. We get so busy on what we're trying to do, we miss all that's happening around us. We're here today to say, have an awareness of the resources that are around you that are already paid for your tax dollars, that are already there to help you. You will be amazed at what we get into today. All the things that SBA touches for free with government contracting, training, how to get money, getting capital ready. If you're a veteran, if you're a woman in business, if you're from a rural community, you know, if you're in a historically underutilized population, just haven't had the resources before. We're here to shed light on that. We're here to connect with you guys. And nothing makes me more excited now than to get a chance to get you connected with Vicki Evans, because we're all real people. The mayor has a great story. If you don't know it, you should know his small business story. I think it's always important for people to know who's standing up here with a microphone. Anybody can talk, but have they lived it? Do they continue to live it? Do they share in your struggle and your story? We all fail, we succeed, we look for opportunity. So it's kind of my pleasure now to get a chance to have Vicki Evans maybe say hello and speak a little bit. She's one of your own. I'm from North Carolina. Got family in South Carolina, so it's good to be part of the South Carolina family and be here today. But without further ado, I'll let Vicki introduce herself, talk about her business. And I think that your family chapters are important too, how you got here. You know, you've had a challenging few years, but multi-million dollar contracts that this young lady now pervades over on a national level, that you're about to hear something that's going to get your attention. Ms. Vicki, give her a hand.
Well, good morning, everyone. Hope everyone's doing well. I am excited to be here. And before I tell you about my company, I'd like to tell you where I started from. Okay? So I'm from Louisiana. And what do we do in Louisiana? We cook and we eat all the time, right? It is very good food. And me, I come from a very large family. I have 10 brothers, and I did say 10. And I am number 10, so I have one that's younger than I am, but he acts like he's older than me. So I'm in the kitchen all the time. And when as I moved into adulthood, I decided that I didn't want to be anywhere near the kitchen cooking. So my career path was in network engineering. So I started off in corporate America, where I was a network engineer and a project manager for several years. I married, had children, and then I had a very devastating situation occur with my immediate family. So I had to figure out something that I could do to give me more flexibility to spend more time with my family. And for me, that was starting my own company back in 2008. So my company, Korg,
managing time to start a business.
Yeah. Yes. How about that?
That's right. Yes. So I actually started out in real estate. So CORD, my company name, is actually an acronym for Connect One Realty Group. And my tagline used to be the perfect connection for all of your real estate needs. Well, as I was in real estate and we had the housing crash, I moved into default services, doing asset management for agencies such as HUD and Department of Veteran Affairs and some of the other agencies like Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. So we began doing asset management, and that moved me into renovation repairs and on into construction. Hence, that's where we are today. So, Core Management Group, we started off in Georgia, then we moved our office here into South Carolina. It's best things since sliced bread when I moved here. Oh my gosh, my business took off. So we went from a staff of 14, we're at 60 employees. And so we've had phenomenal growth. And like Alan said, we have had multi-million dollar contracts to include the entire state of South Carolina for GSA, one of the government agencies where we manage many of the federal buildings and courthouses that you have here in South Carolina. So one thing that I did realize as I was getting into the business and getting my 8A and working with SBA, there were so many opportunities to work with other small businesses to see, you know, what were my gaps at and where I could use assistance at from other companies that had maybe core competencies that I didn't have. So there was an opportunity for teaming. So that was something that was really big, learning about teaming and joint ventures and mentor-protege programs. So we took advantage of being part of some of the state programs like SCDOT, being a DBE. So they had a lot of training classes along with SBA. So we have taken advantage of all of those resources that contribute to our growth of being a multi-million dollar company now. So we are excited about our path.
I'd love for you to talk a little bit more about two items. One, your path with SBA, and how you utilized and how that helped you grow your business, but also about the gap. To me, that is one of the, my family, I'm going to use this one, my family lived here
from Switzerland in 1967, and my dad was basically the reason they came here is because leaders in the upstate said, if we want our textile industry and our chemical industry to really survive foreign competition and everything else, we need to fill gaps that enhance our businesses. And I think that's where you're headed. I'd love for you to share with everybody a little bit more of those two items, because I do think the pathway with SBA and the process scares people at first, but the benefits can be long. And the second part to it is that collaboration, the gap, because there could be ways to partner with other businesses to fill the different gaps and working together. And a lot of times we, as small businesses, we get so focused on our business, and sometimes we look at people as competition when they actually could complement our business.
Okay, so I'll start off with my journey with SBA. So I am an 8A participant, and it's a 9-year program. And it's about business development. And it truly assisted me in developing my business. Like I said before, I went from having a staff of a team of 14 to almost 60 people now. Being in the 8A program, it introduced me to opportunities and visibility that I might not have endured without being part of the SBA program. So some of the federal opportunities that we could bid on and the state opportunities that I didn't know about or even how to get to those programs. Some of the resources they have for databases that show you where to go and what to do and how to do it. For instance, bonding. I didn't know anything about bonding. So learning about the SBA bonding program, that was very helpful for me because it's like, well, how do you get that? Most construction projects, you have to have bonding. And so I didn't know anything about it, but going through the SBA program, it actually showed me how to do that. and where to go and who to talk to about getting that. And so those are some of the programs that the SBA had to assist me. Training. We do lots of training, a lot of avenues for assisting small businesses to grow. The mentor-protege program. So let's just say you're a small business and you're trying to learn how to get, for instance, I secured a 5-year contract working in Puerto Rico. And that was through a joint. So somebody said, ooh. Okay, so I didn't know anything about Puerto Rico for the most part, but I teamed with someone who did. Someone, he was an ex-military, exo in the military, and he was retired, and he had come through the 8A program. So I teamed with him in a joint venture, and we were able to secure that contract, and I got all kinds of experience from that, which led to me managing some of the projects up in Greenville, South Carolina. And so getting that type of experience and teaming and learning about other organizations was very helpful for me. Learning more about your insurance and what you need to do for workers' comp and all of those. That I didn't know a lot about those, but you know, I had this small business and I knew what my capability was, but I just didn't know how to maneuver. And so the SBA really helped me with that. So I'll talk about those gaps. Again, you don't know what you don't know until you get there, right? So having some of the contracts that we are on, I may have needed an engineering firm. Well, I'm not an engineering firm. I do mechanical work, but some of the projects we have, they may require a design build. So I wind up teaming with engineering firms that did have that capability, and once we packaged our proposal, then that was one proposal because it filled the gap that I didn't have. So some of the areas that you may want to get in, you seek out a company that may have those capabilities, and it's important. It's important because working with someone is like a marriage. Teaming with someone is like a marriage, so you want to make sure you do your vetting. And the SBA, again, is very instrumental in helping you, making sure you're dotting all your I's and crossing all your T's as you go into these teaming and joint ventures and mentor-protege programs that can help you be successful.
I want to hit on something real quick because you made a very important point, and it covers everybody in this room. And we talked about it a little bit before we came on stage. Everyone needs to understand to, you know, sometimes you look at somebody that's been successful in business and you're like, you know, they're not 7 foot tall. You know, they didn't go to Duke or wherever. How did they do it? And Vicki mentioned this before we came on, and I 100% agree with her. You got to understand to be successful, one of the big successful elements, a big variable is you can't be the subject matter expert on all things. You can't be the subject matter expert on a lot. But there are a lot of smart people out there. I had a friend who has a pretty successful business. And he says, you know, an angel gets a star for every Duke grad or Carolina grad he hires to work for him, right? Well, he's Carolina grad, right? But understand that don't be intimidated by the opportunity. There are resources. Your skill set needs to be to identify talent that can help you succeed and vet that talent and get the capital and resources you need to be successful. Vicki, I just wanted to amen on you on that one. I thought that was super important. And also want to brag about her a moment. A couple months ago, we were in Atlanta, and one of the programs, so just so you know, the core pieces of SBA, we cover several key things. Many people got familiar, more familiar with SBA from the PPP program, the EIDL loans, post-pandemic, but SBA's been here for 70 years. President Dwight Eisenhower founded the SBA when he was head Joint Chiefs of Staff World War II. He saw these massive, a handful of contractors control billions of U.S. investment post-World War II and World War II. The goal there was at 23%, and that's where it is now, of all government contracting goes to small business. And part of SBA's job is to be the gatekeeper to make sure those type of things happen. The other part of SBA's mission is training. on a significant scale. Just like me, when I started a company back in 99, I came back to myself and a couple of partners in an extra bedroom, right? We had an idea on a napkin. We knew some technology, we knew a few other things, and we knew how to put a business together, not really how to raise capital. SBA helps you with training. It also gets you capital ready. And we have specialized groups for veterans, as I mentioned before, you know, for underutilized populations, for rural, for women's business centers, all, and Greg White is here, please get to him or go to SBA.gov to find out a little more. But one of the programs I want to highlight is the 8A program, which you mentioned. The 8A program is phenomenal. I guess that began back in the 70s maybe, if I'm Greg, is that correct? And that program was meant to be, not only did we want to make sure that 23% of all $680 billion in annual spending the government does in contracting, 23% of that goes to small business. We want to make sure that certain populations that quite frankly weren't at the table, weren't given the opportunity, at least were given the opportunity to be at the table. The 8A program is a phenomenal one that if you've had a business for 2 years of tax returns, right, Vicki? You can apply for the 8A, write this one down, program, and the opportunity to have a 9-year period within this program where you could have potentially set aside government contracts to be a sub or a prime. Other government contracts will seek you out. It's a training program for 9 years and a utilization program that has created generational wealth for families, generational. And we were in Atlanta, there was 2,000 8A participants, which she's one of, and there's probably 6,000 at some point in the program. And we highlighted your story because you got to be inspired by real world activity and what's kind of happening out here, especially in South Carolina. So Vicki, if you will, you mentioned it before, but be willing to find mentors, being a mentor, being willing to partner. I think it's even beyond marriage. Some of these business partnerships, but if you'll talk about that a little bit,
yes,
if that applies to everybody in the room.
Yes. And I'll tell you, you know, sometimes you get a divorce, right? So all marriages do not work. But for me, when I first got into the program, I did team with someone. I was in a joint venture with someone, and it wasn't a good situation. As a matter of fact, I didn't learn anything from that person or that company. And my goal was to learn as much as I could so that I could develop my company. Well, we wound up, I went to the SBA, and they were very instrumental in kind of guiding me through the process. And I wound up not working, didn't work out at all. And so, but I didn't give up, did not give up. So I did move into other joint ventures, again, looking for those companies that had expertise that my company was lacking so that I could gain that experience. Most of the joint ventures are for 2 years. They start up, the SBA will approve those for 2 years, and some of those are, again, mentor protege programs where a company, a larger company, can come in and mentor you and help you with financial resources or even space in their office and give you some guidance on your HR, guidance on your accounting systems. And I need to stress that. The accounting system, making sure that your financials are in order, is huge. Because it can prevent you from getting additional working capital or resources that you may need further along in your business, right? And even with the bonding, if you're in construction. So for me, being a woman and being a minority in construction has had its challenges. But because I had all of my, I'm going to say, ducks in a row, my finances aligned, I had my organizational chart, and like I was sharing with Alan, that I brought on those subject matter experts to help me because I couldn't do everything myself.
Right, that's great. And so understand that there's a full portfolio within SBA, and in my business world, you know, Vicki Pryor, some projects that we've done, you know, in the Carolinas. SBA is very involved in traditional lending.
Yes.
Understand that in this region alone, the Southeast, we did $8 billion with a B in traditional lending that SBA did, where you go in and talk to your bank, and the 504 program, write that one down, 504 or 7A lending, And these different lending vehicles, it depends on what you need. If you need cash flow to expand or grow a business, if you need whatever equipment that you may need, physical plant, if you need to buy land, if you need to buy a building, understand that SBA does significant lending. And here's how that works. Banks would not lend to small businesses if it weren't for the SBA lending program. SBA and many of these financial vehicles, we back that loan. We're the one, you'll go deal with a bank, but at the SBA lending program, I was at the lender conference in Asheville a week and a half ago with all the lenders there. So you walk into a traditional bank, ask if they have SBA loans, or we can connect you. We can do a connect through SBA. And they'll take a look at your business plan and make a decision on SBA financing. Normally, it's a great program because the rates and the terms and all those elements are catered more to small businesses and what you may need. And also importantly, being from this part of the country, disaster lending. Fortunately and unfortunately, I had my first week on the job at SBA a couple of years ago, 25 tornadoes hit Tennessee. And we all know FEMA shows up, with a jacket on and makes sure everybody's safe. But SBA shows up and stays for multiple years. And we've spent millions in just that community, for example, but all kinds of when there's hurricanes, disasters, or whatever, SBA is there for you with direct lending to be able to get you to the other side, not just where you were before, but often rebuilding business, entire business districts and homes as well, making them safer, more secure, and stabilizing communities. So trying to think of what else I want to mention here. CDC, we have small microloan programs we do as well. And again, Greg can clue you in on that and go to SBA. I'm teasing you for his Small Business Week event. It's going to be in a couple weeks. But we're going to have multiple tables around here from all of our resource partners that we were mentioning. Our retired executives, our veterans business outreach, our women's business, where you're going to be able to walk up and have an extended conversation or sign up for virtual events. And I'll hand it back to you.
And I was
going to
add, at those events, they have matchmaking. So they bring in agencies that are looking for small businesses like ours, and you are able to do matchmaking events and sit down one-on-one and talk with those agencies and present your company to them, and that may yield you a contract. And I've done that before with EPA. I secured a contract just by having a conversation with them and showing them the capabilities of my company. So that was very helpful as well, and something that SBA promotes a lot.
I was talking to somebody the other day who had an opportunity to work with SBA to actually double the size of their business. They had an opportunity to buy another franchise area. They became well established here, made great investments, but then they could go, they had an opportunity to purchase another market. They doubled their business, they stretched, and they couldn't have done it without the SBA. And at first they had never thought about using the SBA as a program. So, you heard him, Alan, talk about micro, but we're talking about loans that range from
millions, right? Where are we at now? Five? Yeah. We're five and continue to work to expand that, and they can piggyback on other lending vehicles that you may use. So that's significant funding. We built a marina a few years ago. No bank would touch us. Post 2008 and all the asset toxicity that a lot of banks were dealing with, and SBA funded that massive project. So we're talking everything from micro lending all the way up to close to 5 million plus, and we'll work with other agencies, USDA does lending. And so understand, if you're an entrepreneur, you don't know where agencies begin and end, and we don't care either. We'll connect you to other opportunities that you can cobble together to help you achieve your dream and kind of get there.
Yeah, I think it's a perfect segue for us, as we continue to bring these resources, and you're hearing it live today, what's out there. But on Wednesday, May 1st, we are hosting our 11th annual Small Business Week conference. It's going to be at the Embassy Suites at Greystone. We've got keynote speaker Dr. Stephanie Kirkland, but you're also going to have social media expert Ken Walker there, who's going to play the master of ceremony, but he's also going to tell you about what he's been doing in the social media world and how that's affecting businesses and highlight, because look, today the social media is a big part of understanding how to leverage. Now, who knows what's going to happen with TikTok or just Instagram? Part of what we're trying to do in the city is to constantly highlight small businesses. But when you have other small businesses highlighting other small businesses, it's a bigger impact. We can continue to do that. And one of the things that I'm hoping is that we have more networking opportunities, more that people realize we can help each other. You know, small businesses ought to be thinking back and sharing this information with others. I never understood, like, if I couldn't do a catering job where I was in the restaurant business, I would call one of the other small guys that I worked with and said, hey, are you open? Can I send this client to you? Sharing resources so that we continue to keep that money local. And one of our challenges in the city has been we spend millions of dollars a year, but we've gotten in our own way through procedures to get some of the small businesses more engaged, and our goal is to continue to try to change that. Are we there yet? Absolutely not, but we're going to continue. And, you know, I'd love to hear from Victoria, Victory. Monday, I feel like Monday morning today. Vicky, about, you know, what good examples are out there that we can go emulate, because our goal is to spend as much as our money locally as we can. And why is that important? Small businesses grow here, stay here, and invest here. And, you know, when a company gives back and the community embraces it, it makes for a bet. It works all the way. It makes our neighborhood strong. It makes our business community strong. It makes us attractive for other investments. And so the gap piece, I think, is so important, which we haven't done. You know, going out and talking to our small businesses and saying, hey, what gap could enhance your business? So as we're thinking about recruitment, you know, it used to be, and I'll tell the story, so on Divine Street, I opened my first restaurant in 1994. Right across the street was Divine Foods. Angela, he didn't talk to me for a year. He was so mad that I opened up across the street from him because he thought I was going to steal his customers. And after about a year and a half, he came over one Friday night, he brought a bottle of wine, and he goes, I got to thank you. My business has increased 25%.
It always happens like that. Critical mass.
Yeah. But I do think it's important that we engage with each other and share, but also how do we leverage? You know, how can we work together as small businesses? Maybe it's an alliance, buying power. All the things that you see bigger corporations do, even though they're competing. I mean, there are medical groups here in our community that compete against each other. But they created an alliance. Why? So they could work with the insurance companies to make sure that they get the best rates. The working with suppliers from vaccinations, others, so that they could get the best pricing so they could stay competitive and take care of their customer base. So these are all opportunities, and that's why we wanted to host this, not only to let people know what resources are out there, but also for people to have an opportunity to meet each other, figure out, well, how can we work together? We're going to continue to work as a city to improve. We have such an excellent staff, which I think the next panel is really going to kick it off. Alan, you want to talk about that?
Well, the next phase of our discussion this morning is people continue to fill in. I know we got Aisha Driggers, the director of the City of Columbia's Office of Business Opportunities. We have a great panel that she's going to introduce. I do want to mention one thing you said about alliances. This is exciting for you all to understand of the piece that SBA touches. We all know AI, how that has transformed business in the past 12 months. In another 12 months, it will be exponentially even more. If you're not aware of that, understand that SBA is working in that realm to kind of vet information that can be trusted. Always understand that an agency like the city or the SBA is a good vetted source. There's so much junk, as we all know on the internet. We often talk about, I'm drowning in information, I'm starving for knowledge. That's what I feel like in the digital realm. The SBA has something called the Digital Alliance, where we work with Microsoft and Apple. We vet for you what is trusted source information. And we also help you with cybersecurity for small businesses. But anyway, this group that we've got coming on now, Aisha, I'm so excited for the panel that's about to come on. And these are all local businesses. They'll tell you about their successes and what you need to do to have opportunities here. So we'll step out of the way. Thank you, Matt.
I just want to piggyback on the AI. That is something that's coming down the road that we hope to share with everyone as well. As we're exploring, we're bringing in some subject matter experts because AI is here. And how do we embrace it to help enhance our businesses, our operations, but also protect ourselves? It was very interesting. I attended a conference with 28 other mayors, and this was the subject matter of learning how to embrace AI. But at the same time, it was very interesting is a lot of the folks in the technology world said it's up to you local leaders to really help build some guardrails and some protection around it. So as we continue to go through that, we hope to share more information on AI as well with everyone.
All right, Aisha, thank you.
Good morning. It's so good to see everyone today. I'd like to invite our panelists to come to the stage. First, we have Pam with the Richland County Office of Small Business Opportunity. Kelly with the City of Columbia Business License Office. Dom with the President and CEO of Optus Bank. And Michelle Abraham with South Carolina Small Business Development Centers of Columbia. Thank you. So I'm Aisha. I'm the director for our City of Columbia Office of Business Opportunities. And we have the pleasure to work with this lovely panel all the time. So we're excited that you all agree to join us today. So I want to start by allowing you to share who you are, who you represent today, and the scope of your service. Michelle, you can start.
Okay, is this, no,
is that on?
Yeah, okay, great. My name is Michelle Abraham, and I am the State Director for the South Carolina Small Business Development Centers. We are part of a national network. There are SBDCs throughout the country, and we are a resource partner to the SBA. We provide no-fee business consulting to anyone who is considered a small business, regardless of whether you're just starting out or whether you've been in business for 15 years. We're here to provide assistance to you. We're like an extension of your business. So think about big corporations and all the departments that they have. We help you with all those things, marketing, sales strategies, strategic planning, helping you figure out where and how to go get access to capital, financial management of your business, HR, and we have specialty programs. We have experts in procurement and government contracting, in international trade, in technology, in new product commercialization, all kinds of things like that. So no cost, private, confidential business consulting to anyone, as long as your business is legal, and training programs that are either free or very affordable. And because we are statewide, we have a group of about 55 people across the state. We cover the entire state. And when you come to work with us, you have access to our entire team of people. Everything is confidential. But we, as I said, we work with people for the lifespan of their business, no matter where you are, and bring in expertise not only from our organization, but from others as well, to try to help surround you with credible, reliable, trustworthy resources.
Thank you, Chef Kelly. Good morning, everybody. So I work in the business licensing. I'm the business license administrator for the City of Columbia. So if you are starting a new business or renewing a business, you would want to come see our team here in the city. Anyone who's engaging in business or intending to engage in business, you would need a business license, and I'll go over the process with you later. But yeah, we regulate the business license ordinance and make sure that you guys have the tools you need to operate in compliance.
Good morning, and it's great to see each of you. As he stated earlier, coming out on a rainy, kind of dreary day today. I'm Pam Green, manager of the Office of Small Business Opportunity for Richland County. The purpose of our office is to initially run a program called the Small Local Business Enterprise Program. And the purpose of that is to ensure that the county is using a race and gender neutral tool to use in its procurement measures. So So we look to bring into our fold small businesses that are located in Richland County or have a workforce that has at least 25% of them coming or being residents of Richland County to be a part of a directory or database of businesses in Richland County. And we look to advocate for all of those small business owners as far as procurement and contracting with Richland County. That is like the main focus. And then the other resolves around not only advocacy, but also workshop trainings, whether it be technical assistance, looking for ways to provide networking opportunities for business-to-business interactions. And we'll get more in detail about that. But the areas of certified categories for us deal with construction, architecture, engineering, professional services, those that require some specialized credentials, non-professional services, and then the wholesale commodities. And so I'm happy to be here to share information on behalf of Richland County.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be here with each of you. It will make even more sense why it's so great to be here with each of you. And I'll share a little bit about Optus Bank's mission and why we exist to really help many, and partner with many folks in this room. Optus Bank is a unique financial institution. Today is the only Columbia-based bank, and it's also one of 22 Black-owned banks in the United States. It's based in South Carolina, Columbia, South Carolina. We're also certified as a community development financial institution. That's a little bit about the core points of difference of the bank. But really, the greatest legacy of our bank and the purpose why we exist today lies in our founding over 100 years ago, 1921. A group of very courageous and visionary African Americans decided that every person really needed to have access to capital and opportunities, regardless where they came from, regardless of the zip code or the inherited privilege or whatever they brought to this world. And they founded this bank in Columbia, South Carolina. And over 100 years later, we're still thriving and really continuing to serve that core mission. Still is very relevant. And we're fortunate to have a mayor who is an entrepreneur and is a pro-business focused mayor that really believes, just like we do, that entrepreneurship is a great pathway to building generational wealth. So our bank is a little bit unique, and we'll talk some about that later. But we bet on entrepreneurs and high potential communities that are underestimated by traditional financial institutions. So we serve everyone in the community, regardless where they came from, regardless what they came to us with. And our goal is every person that leaves our physical branch, and we have two branches, we're building a new one, or our virtual branch, leaves better off in some way, whether it's financial resources, human resources, or social capital. And that's why we're so glad to be partnering with many amazing leaders on this panel.
Thank you so much. So Dom, you had the first question. In our office, we have a commercial revolving loan fund, so we work with Optus often. We have Brett Whiting in the back. Brett, if you'll wait, raise your hand, our loan officer. And he works with Hammond from Optus on a regular basis. They communicate often. So what sets Optus apart from other traditional lenders?
Thank you, Aisha. And thank you, Brett, for what you're doing for this community. I can't tell you how many stories that we have that would not have occurred but for this partnership with the City of Columbia. And so maybe let me share a story, and that will tell you why we're different and how we're different. So just a few days ago, we had the privilege of celebrating a grand opening of one of our small business owners' presence at the airport. So many of you probably know Sandra and Herbert Sims at Home Carolina Concessions. And if you are a frequent flyer like I am, you frequently walk by their amazing facilities that they have developed at the Columbia Airport, which, by the way, is improving by the day. So thank you, Mayor, for what you're doing to make sure that that asset continues to thrive. But you know, Sandra came to our bank years ago because she was really being a little bit overlooked by the more traditional financial institutions. And she's an amazing business person. She should not have been overlooked. She is an incredible business person, one of the best business people I've ever been around. But, you know, but for the work that we've been doing with her, she probably wouldn't have expanded. And she will tell you candidly, she's now opening up Jackson, Mississippi Airport. So she's expanding her business from South Carolina into other states. And one of the reasons she's very generous to attribute that growth to our bank. So what makes us different? So why were we able to help Sandra when some of the more traditional banks couldn't? I'm not saying they wouldn't. I'm not saying they wouldn't even try or they didn't care. They just, for some reason, they were not a good fit. And it starts with our shareholders. You know, we're proud to have about 250 shareholders. Most of them are African American. They direct what we do, right? And they insist that we serve everyone, regardless of their background. And they were very intentional about serving customers that may not fit the traditional bank standards. Don't tell the regulators I said that. So we like to color a little bit outside of the lines, right? We like to be, the five C's of lending are critical, right? You have to have the credit, the capital, the character, and cash flow, and the capacity to do the work that you do. But as you know, there are small business owners. No small business looks alike, right? So every small business is unique, and that requires a unique approach. And frequently, those standard criteria are probably disadvantaging some businesses that could have a chance to succeed. And so what makes us unique is we may work just a little bit harder. We're more intentional, really because of our shareholders and our board that insist that we work hard to make sure everyone gets served, regardless whether they fit that traditional bank box. And it's really good. And it's a privilege every day to be able to maybe just color a little bit outside of the lines.
Thank you. That intentionality is obvious when working with Optus, so we appreciate that. Kelly, my question for you is, can you explain the business license application and renewal process and what the city has done to make that process more business friendly?
Absolutely. So we all know that sometimes forms and processes can be a little overwhelming and a little scary. For business licensing, it's the process to apply for a business license is extremely more simple than you might think. You would come in or you would go online, which we have now, I'll talk about that in a minute, apply through, you know, the form, input all your information. We would go through a clearance process. If you're physically located here in Columbia, we would have to do a clearance process with zoning, make sure that you're able to operate that particular business in that location. We would also go through fire, so we would make sure fire has cleared your business as well to make sure that's safe. And then we would actually go ahead and invoice you and you get your business license right there. So that process is pretty streamlined. When it comes to renewals, that's also pretty streamlined as well. You would report your gross receipts to us, you would pay your tax on that, and then we would be issued a business license. I wrote down some of the enhancements and some of the great things that we've done in business licensing, so I didn't forget anything. So we did create the ability to renew and apply online. That capability wasn't there a couple years ago, so before that you had to mail in your application or walk it into our office, and I see some faces out there like, what? Yeah, that was one of the things, but we definitely made that more easy for our customers. We translated our business application into Spanish. We're working on some other languages as well. We created the ability for online payments. That was not a functionality before. We updated our website to make sure that we had fillable forms for you if you did choose to mail in your forms. We wanted you to have easy access to those. We updated the look and feel. We created a welcome sheet that lays out all of the information that you need to know to continue to be in compliance with the City of Columbia and the Business Licensing Division. We also joined the MASC statewide renewal portal. So now if you have businesses that are in multiple locations, multiple municipalities and counties, you're able to go on the state website and renew your business license. And we also created a self-service portal of our own that would allow you to apply and renew there as well. So we're always looking for ways to make things easier for you guys. We take feedback as well, but everything that we do is to enhance the experience and to make sure that it's not intimidating. We want it to be easy, we want it to be inclusive for everybody to be able to maneuver. And if you guys ever have questions, our office, my division, our team, the City of Columbia team as a whole, but since I work with my division, I'm gonna hype them up. We're really friendly, we're really engaging, we love talking to you guys, we love learning about your business. We're happy to provide other resources in the city or otherwise if you need help. We often refer OBO, folks to OBO as well to get assistance if they need it. But if you are ready to start your business, you know, feel free to come down. We'll help you get through the process. That's what we're here for. We have to enforce our ordinance, but we want to make sure that you guys have an easy experience and that you're not intimidated by it, because I promise you it's not as bad as it looks.
I think an important point to add to was, if you're located in or want to do business with the city, you need a business license. But sometimes that's the question we get, do I need to have a business license?
Yes, absolutely. Anyone intending to engage in or engaging in business, you know, generating revenue, advertising, things like that, then you would need a business license. So,
thank you so much.
Can I ask a question?
We're going to take questions in a moment. Thank you. What support, Michelle, what support or resources are available for small businesses looking to navigate the procurement process within our community?
Okay. Well, first I want to make one comment to all of you that are small business owners or looking to get in business. If there's one takeaway I'd like to see you all have from today, it's that there are so many phenomenal resources available to you at no charge. In this room of the city, you're hearing about the phenomenal types of services they have. Dom and his bank and other lenders, the SBA and the programs that they have, our group, there are many of us out there, so use our resources. Don't try to do it in isolation on your own. Come to us, if you've got a question and you're not sure, come to one of us and we'll get you directed to the right place. Here in South Carolina, we have such a great camaraderie and community effort. We all work together. We don't want to see you go on the internet and spend $10,000 to get a website set up when you can do it for $200. So use us. If that's the, you know, the biggest takeaway, I just wanted to make that point. But from a procurement standpoint, you know, when you think about getting into doing business with the government, whether it's your local city or county, whether it's the state, whether it's at the federal level, there are many, many resources out there, and Vicki talked about some of those. Our organization, as I mentioned, we have specialists that they'd probably kill me if they heard me say this, but between the three of them, they've probably got at least 80 or 90 years of experience in this field. So they will sit down with you and help you understand, what do I have to do to really qualify to do government contracting? It's a different world than just selling out there in the community. You have to have proper financial systems set up. You have to understand all the regulations. You have to get signed up with certain entities to be eligible and qualified. Lots of things to do, which isn't necessarily that complicated, but if you're trying to do it on your own without guidance, you can make a lot of missteps and go the wrong way. So, our organization will do that, will help you with all aspects of it. There are other organizations out there. The city certainly has lots of resources to help you with that. There is another organization called APEX that we actually operated for many years, but they help people that are focused on government contracting. So lots of us as a community that will help you with all aspects of it. And particularly just kind of thinking about, you know, if you want to do procurement, working with the city or the state is a great place to start. We have so many people that come to us and they think, I want to jump into a great big federal contract right out of the boot. And Vicki's laughing because that's probably not the best place to start if you don't have the experience. You know, work with some of our local entities, get some good experience, perform on it, prove that you can do it. And as you're doing that, we can help you get connected and work your way up in the larger contracts.
Good. Thank you so much, Michelle. And you mentioned APEX. I know we have Angela Seymour here from APEX. She's raising her hand back there, and another APEX representative. And I know our City of Columbia procurement team is in the back as well, Anita and Nadia. So definitely we have that representation here if you have procurement-related questions. Pam, so how can small businesses directly engage with your organization and build meaningful relationships for potential opportunities?
So as you can see up here, we have our contact information. Obviously, if you're interested in being a part of our database or connecting with us as it relates to any type of training, you can email us, or you can give us a call, or you can go to Richland County, sc.gov/OSBO. I'll talk from the standpoint of our Small Local Business Enterprise Program. That is like a gateway into our organization. What you're wanting to do, and I think in the past we've directed folks to, because it's all online, you can go on, register to be certified as a business, upload your information. But we've shifted some to make sure that we are doing more personal approaches with our businesses. I think Vicki talked about a lot of, you don't know what you don't know. And so for us, what we've done now is we've put into play of setting appointments. So I feel the best way to engage with us is either to give us a call, I also have my cards available to you all as well, or to email us, and our business development person is going to contact you, set up an appointment. And then we're going to walk you through the documents, and then we're going to talk about why do you want to be a part of the Small Local Business Enterprise database of businesses, and what does that mean? And then we also talk about how we work with procurement. How do we advocate for you as a small business? What do you need to do? What do you need to have in play? So for me, it is more of the personal touch. And I say, I believe it was Alan saying, you need to know who's up on the stage when we're talking and we're advocating for businesses. I've owned a business. I owned a business with an ex-husband. We were great partners as business partners. We were not great married. So I say that from the standpoint, you're dealing with teams that understand your walk. So I say to the folks that come into my office, I understand contracting. I understand the struggles of being in business. I understand the importance of, you know, those times where you're really wanting to kind of intermingle personal funds that really need to stay on the business side. And then I've got 30 years of banking experience in working in the lending capacity with small businesses. So you get that whenever you're walking into these offices of very passionate people about entrepreneurship. But I think I answered the question.
Thank you so much, Dan. All right. So, Dom, in your experience, what common challenges do small businesses face in engaging with banks, and how can these obstacles be addressed?
I think this room has a lot of resources to close those gaps that exist. So I'll put it in context. So our bank is relatively small, but we did grow over 1,000% up in the last 5 years, to over almost $550 million. And most of the growth is directed to small businesses. So most of our lending, almost $500 million in lending that we've done since I've been at the bank, is small businesses. And so we learned a little bit about what it takes. And it frequently takes more than just financial capital for a business to succeed. And so maybe I'll just personalize it a little bit. Pam, you did, and then the mayor did, so I'm an immigrant too. I started a small business, and what I really was lacking is the social capital, the connections in the community. I had access to financial capital because I was an executive at a bank, so I had money, but our access to it. But I didn't have the social connections, and I also didn't know how to run a business, even though I was a banker, but I didn't know how to actually run the business. So what we see in our community when we serve, and by the way, almost 100% of our loans last year, 97% of our loans went to minority-owned businesses, women-owned businesses, or businesses located in underserved communities. So almost 100% of our lending is directed to communities that are underserved in some way. Maybe it's historically, they come to us. So from that experience I can share, we frequently find businesses that come that they lack one of those three sources of capital. May not have the connections, they may not have the know-how, not because they're not capable of gaining that know-how, but that's not what they do. They're really good at running a restaurant, or they're really good at building a widget, or doing manufacturing. We have some great businesses in Columbia that do manufacturing. So that's why I think the resources that are represented on this panel are amazing, because you can close some of those gaps. So the greatest to make it really tangible, one of the greatest obstacles we have is on the financial side. This is where the SBA and the work that you do and Greg, you and your great team does, is that sometimes in closing that financial gap, a lot of customers come to us, maybe they like a little bit of the down payment that they need, that cash that they need to bring to the table. Right? They didn't come to this world with that money, right? Someone helped them along, and they may not have enough, right, to bring to the closing table. In other cases, they come in and they may not have their financial statements together. They have great business that's cash flowing already. They're trying to expand this, but they don't have their financials. They're commingling their funds, and so that's when a lot of the work that we partner with organizations, many in this room, to help bring those financial statements up to par so that the banker understands what's going on with the business without us getting involved. And then finally, I'll say this is probably the most important one, is that social capital. We frequently connect our business owners with other resources. And just like the mayor said, that competition is sometimes good. But sometimes we even refer them to other financial institutions if we believe that they're better equipped to serve that business. So we connect them with lawyers, we connect them with accountants, we connect them with other resources in the community. Sometimes we hire them to do our catering at the bank and kind of use that as a coaching moment for them to get better. So that social capital is as important and important to close those gaps that exist in that social network as it is financial capital or just the human capital, the know-how.
So anyone can answer this. What types of opportunities are there for small businesses to partner with your organization?
So if you were to go out, we have an e-procurement portal called Bonfire. There are a number of opportunities that are out there. A lot of times you're hearing with Richland County about a lot of the transportation projects that are out there that are funded by the penny. But there are a number of other opportunities that are available to you, and we just ask that you take a look and source. Our office actually tries to source through this pretty much daily and send out the information to our small local businesses to let them know of opportunities. But when we take a look at the 30, 35, 40 different departments that are at the county, they're always procuring something. So just to give you an idea, there are some projects where they're looking for general contractors with the Avalanche Glen Detention Center. We're also looking for someone that can help with the redesign of websites for a number of different departments. We're also looking for someone to come up with a plan for like a prehistoric district of how that can be unveiled to the public. So there are a number of different things that are out there. You just need to make it a point once you're part of, which is why we have you come in for the appointments to talk through what am I looking at when I go here and what do I need to do. But there are so many things, and I won't just talk just Richland County, but as Michelle has stated, with the state, with the city, you know, the state is one of the largest procurer of goods and services. So that's anything from toilet tissue to consulting to whatever that may be. So there are opportunities for many of you in the room. We just have to figure out ways to source that information in your best way to get.
Well, for the Small Business Development Centers, also known as the SBDC, anybody in this room can partner with us. And again, there's no charge for it. Our website is scsbdc.com. And you can go on there and click the button at the top right and sign up to get assistance. Again, it's completely confidential, and we will work with you. We don't really want to come in and just work with you on a one-off issue. What we want to do is develop that relationship like a lender would and work with you over time. We have many clients we've worked with for 15 or 20 years, like Tracy. You know, we've worked with a company called Jordan Construction, which many of you may have heard of, and they started out, we worked with them from the very beginning, and they've grown by leaps and bounds. They were featured on 60 Minutes last year. Karen Jenkins here in Columbia has a great business, LLC Construction. These are businesses that we continue to work with, not just from the very beginning, but all along the growth. And, you know, some of the services we provide may change as time goes along and your needs change, but that's why we're here. My folks, about 55 people around the state, almost everybody is a small or has been a small business owner. We have a lot of people that have come out of banking and have worked extensively with small businesses, and we know all the lenders. I mean, probably about anybody in here would be a great candidate potentially for Dom's bank, for Optus. But we know all the lenders, so if you're not sure, come to us. We will help you get your ducks in a row, as somebody said earlier, it was Tracy that said that, and help you put that package together so that, and figure out what lenders have products that fit you, so that when you go to them, you've got a really high probability of success. So, and again, I've got cards with me, happy to help in any way. And as Tracy said earlier, and I grew up, or Vicki, sorry. Did I say Tracy before? I'm so sorry. I'm Monday. Like, you're Mayor. It must be Monday. You don't know what you don't know. That is so well stated. And so seek out your resources. When I owned two businesses when I started out, I didn't know about the SBDC and a lot of these other resources. I wish I had, because it certainly would have helped me along the way, so use them.
That's great, yeah. We always say that Columbia has a great ecosystem for our small business community, and we collaborate all the time on the events. On the May 1st event, we'll have all of our partners there representing and providing information to anyone who wants to meet with them one-on-one. So my final question before we wrap up is, can you offer one piece of advice to small businesses aiming to participate in opportunities? And Doc, we can start with you and come down.
It's hard for me to say which one in particular, but I think you asked about the resources, so maybe I'll try to merge the two questions a little bit. I think everyone in this room can be a resource for each other, and I do think Columbia has a fantastic ecosystem. But also, I think it's important to be very intentional, even as a small business owner that you're just getting started, being intentional about doing business with other small businesses. Because you never know, you know, when that relationship is going to be beneficial to you. And so being intentional about creating your own ecosystem. We are at Altus Bank, we're building a new branch. We were very intentional about using local businesses to do every part of that construction. We said every dollar needs to be going to a locally owned business. That we spent. So imagine if everyone in this room did that with all of their spending power. I bet we would have 100 small businesses in Columbia.
And Dom stole my word because I was going to talk about being intentional. But every time that you have an opportunity to be in the front of resources, making sure that you actually use those resources, reach out to us. The other piece is understanding your capacity. Your financials, key. I'll throw this a shameless plug. We do have a couple of workshops, one being a virtual today, starting at noon. It's the power of go and making sure that your business is on go, ready, willing, and able. And I have some stuff with me if you want to. I think you can still actually register for that event. And then in April, we're gonna be talking about financials. And it's talking about how can you not outgrow your business, also how to grow your business, but really what does it mean from a cash flow standpoint? Because often that particular piece of financial information is ignored, your cash flow. So we'll have that coming up April 24th. I'll have information for that as well. So just the nugget is understanding your capacity and really understanding your numbers.
And I would say ask questions. Don't be scared to ask questions. You know, like I said before, sometimes forms and processes can be intimidating. And if you allow that to take over, sometimes that'll make you deviate from the goal, the end goal that you have. So I would say don't let things like getting licensed at the City of Columbia for your business intimidate you. Ask questions, come in, come talk to us, look online. You know, we're always happy to help you.
Yeah, and just as I said before, and everybody here said, use your resources, find them, use them, take advantage of it, surround yourself with knowledgeable, expert people that can help you along the way. Many people want to help you. You may not feel that way sometimes when you're out there on your own, but it is the truth. And I would also reiterate what Pam just said. The number one reason small businesses fail is poor financial management. You know, you come into business, you've got a great product, a great service, you're really expert in that, but you don't necessarily know how to run the business financially, so make sure you're getting that support. And then I will just put a plug in again for the May 1st event. That is going to be a phenomenal event, so I would encourage you to attend that. We are also, the SBDC, along with our counterparts in North Carolina, are hosting a similar type of event on September 5th in Greenville. And we will have state and local agencies, buyers from both states there that you can sit down and talk with directly, go to some training sessions, hear panelists like this. So I would encourage you to see that or attend that, and there'll be more information forthcoming. You can always go to our website.
Well, thank you all. We like to stay in our office. We might not have all the answers, but hopefully you know someone we can connect a client to, and you've all been excellent partners to the City of Columbia, so we appreciate that continued partnership. Their contact information is on the screen, so if you have any questions, any follow-up questions. And I believe Greg White is going to do our Q&A session. I know Jennifer has a question.
One last panel, please stay up here, because I'm sure some questions will be answered. First of all, let me know, I'm Greg White, Small Business Administration in South Carolina. We're located at Strongfield Federal Building. We oversee the counseling area, which is the Small Business Development Center, Score Chapters, Women's Business Center, the Veterans Business Outreach Center we have across the state. We also oversee the capital program, which we're talking about, the lending programs, microloans, 780-504, surety bond programs. We have resources to help you find those lenders that you need for your business to grow. Then we have also see the contract program that Victor talked about. There's several of those. There's the 8-8 program, there's a small disadvantaged businesses, there's a women-owned businesses, and veteran-owned businesses. So there's like several opportunities for small businesses to get involved in federal contracting. And now it's 23% of all federal contract programs should go to small businesses, so we oversee that. And finally, the third aspect of it is disaster. See, if we went through the COVID program, we had all the COVID loans, all the COVID PPP loans, the EIDL loans, we had all of those. We also, right now, we have a declaration in Bedford County for the tornado that there in flood in 2015. If you remember that, we oversaw those funds that came through SBA. So SBA does a lot of oversight and support. We don't have the personnel to handle each and every item that's on the resource department like you see up here. So we're going to start out with questions today. We've had all the professionals here. Now this is what's important thing is to get your feedback and get your needs met. So if you've got a question you want us to answer, I'm sure the mayor's here and the Alan's still here. We'll try our best to answer. If we don't have an answer for you, we'll get back to you. So anybody have any questions they want to ask? Yes, ma'am. Nonprofits. I can handle that real quick. Typically, SBA and our programs are for-profit entities, except for disaster programs. With disasters, we do handle the nonprofits. Some of the other federal agencies, such as USDA, HUD, they do work with nonprofits, and they do have loan programs and grant programs that may be able to assist you. Yes, ma'am.
So what is the government's position now on affirmative action and set-asides for your contracts?
That has not changed.
I didn't think so, but I will just say that I've had an experience with the local municipality that they don't feel affirmative action is something that, you know, they are engaging in. So I want to know, is there a problem with set-asides? Is there not a problem with it? You know, because for a small business to get up, the set-asides are absolutely key to helping, especially in construction.
The federal programs have not changed their set-aside programs whatsoever.
Well, I notice when I go on Sam's, just saying, that there are very few woman opportunities. And hardly any in the South. Seen some in Idaho and the state parks that are out in the nowhere land and things like that. What do you think that there is really in the opportunity section for women-owned businesses, especially women in construction?
That has not changed. Everybody has an equal opportunity through the federal government programs. We're continuing to advance. If you have a specific need or concern, please contact us.
I'm sorry, let me address that question.
Okay, great.
So I have received woman-owned, 8A, HUD-owned, several of the subsidies. And it hasn't changed for me. And just in the last week, I've probably gotten three in the last week. So I would say the 8A program, I don't know if you're in the 8A program.
I've applied before, and that's a whole separate discussion.
So being in the 8A program, again, it's a business development program. Mm-hmm. But there's life after 8A, so you still have to get out there and market yourself and work with those different agencies to try to get more business. There is a focus on one-on-one opportunities. I've been involved in several of the webinars and meetings.
Do you find those on SAMS, is there like another procurement avenue for that?
Sure, yes, I use SAMS as one of them. And then Michelle said, I don't know if you work with him, but I've been working with you since 2015. So I get a list of all the opportunities that are coming out, whether it's state, federal, or local. And as Ms. Pam said, I mean, I don't know if you work with any of those, their agencies, but I have worked with everybody on this.
I've worked with Scott Bellows.
Okay. Everybody on the stage, I've interacted with their departments. Ms. Benita at office. I've worked with Ms. Benita as well. So I would say take advantage of the resources here. And I don't know if you're trying to be the prime. I started off as a sub or an entertainment partner. And then I moved up to a prime. So once they see the agency, see that you're doing good work and you have good CPARs, they start coming to you.
Well, maybe we can talk about that.
Sure.
So we don't have to take up the time.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I think we could maybe look at the different types of programs. With another 8A contract, somebody like that you can work with.
Right.
Be
great.
We had that conversation last week. Yes, ma'am. That's good. Can you like to come to it?
I just want to piggyback on
the discussion before. So we are with APEX. Me, I'm Jasmine Kennedy, Angela Seymour, and Crystal Morant. We're all procurement counselors with APEX. And what we do is we advise small businesses here in South Carolina with their government contracting needs, whether that's a set-aside certification that you want to apply for, that's opportunities out there with the state of South Carolina, that's state, local, and federal. So like you were saying, you're out there on SAM.gov, looking for these contracting opportunities and you're not finding them. Well, a lot of times, let me just say this, with a lot of our clients, it's not gonna be out there on the website. That's where these networking opportunities come in at. I tell a lot of my clients, depending on the industry you're in, it's not gonna be anything that you're gonna click and find. Like you said, construction. I have my construction clients, they're booming right now, because there's a need for that. And though even those some of those opportunities, they're not finding out there on the website. But with those networking opportunities with these resource partners, even like with SCDOT, what's his name, Crystal? James, I can't remember James' last name, but anyway, if my client says, I'm just not finding anything, I'll call James, and James, he'll tell me where to go, he'll send me things. So it's all about who you know. I mean, that's something that we assist with. I'm gonna be honest with you, my clients that are new to government contracting, I don't start them on SAM.gov, especially depending on the industry they're in. Because SAM.gov, you're gonna get frustrated, you're gonna get overwhelmed, especially if you're not finding anything. Because a lot of these opportunities are not gonna be out there for you to publicly see. A lot of these opportunities, depending on the dollar amount, they don't even have to be publicly advertise. It's not even required for them to publicly advertise.
That was my next question is that almost everything I've seen on SAMS, I think that people that are getting into it need to understand that small business through the SBA is what, $49 million? Is that, am I correct? Am I correct?
Not sure.
Okay. It depends on your business person. So I would, this is my advice,
right?
Take one of my brochures and a business card.
Okay, you need to talk to APACE because that's, we're tasked by the DOD to help businesses grow in the realm of government contracting on the federal, state, and local side of government. We assist with all of these contract opportunities that come out in Richland County, the city of Columbia. We're housed in the USC Incubator Building, so as a part of the University of South Carolina. We also help.
Is that Laurel Street?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
okay, I've been there before, and I'll have to say that Ms. Green has been instrumental. I did get a contract with her, but it was a market ship. Is that correct? Am I saying
market ship?
Yeah. It was what I consider a set aside opportunity, and so yes, I'll contact you again and see if there's something that I'm missing. But
this is great. This is exactly what I'm talking about, because resources connecting is exactly what we'll do. Contacting you with the APACE group.
I contacted you too, Mr. White.
I know. I thought about getting with APACE and meeting with him. I think that's just a great opportunity for you. So let's go on to some other questions. Yes, sir.
Yes. My name is Dion Generate, and I've had the luxury of working with the city of Columbia on different opportunities. And because of OBO, I've sent small business owners there, and sometimes they get frustrated, I guess, with the loan process, maybe. And I hear when you all are talking on the panel, you're mentioning that the financials is where everything gets lost at. What exactly, what programs or whatever that you have in place that exactly, that would, you know, if you had that small business owner that they don't have the financials, is there something that would firsthand help them through all your agencies?
So I'll go ahead real quick. It is to get plugged in into the workshops that are being provided, because we, all of us, try to identify the gaps that small businesses are needing. So we have workshops that target that. You go through your financials, what are you looking at, and then we share it. So you know, Aisha's gonna share whatever workshops we may have going on as well. So it is to make sure, I think you can find on many of our things that we've got.
Yes.
Yeah, always looking through about financials. So
yeah, so anytime any of our partners have an event coming up, we share it on our weekly newsletter. So we're really good about that. But in addition to that, we work closely with SBDC and their staff. When we have a client that's working on a loan package, they have staff that are very familiar with how to format that package to get us what we need when it comes to financials. Of course, we have some criteria that we have to have. We have to have some type of procedure that we loan funds with, but we work very closely with SBDC. If there's a client that is not really sure how to gather their profit and loss statements and things like that. But in addition to that, those workshops and trainings are crucial to making sure that you can understand how to put your financial infrastructure in place.
And we're located, the SBDC, I'm sorry, we're located in the same building as APACE and SCORE and right down the street from the city building, so happy to help with that. We do that day in and day out.
And I'll plug our website, it's sba.gov/sc. You can go there, we put on courses about for lending preparation. See them there, click the website, and do credit courses across the state. That's it.
And Dom, I wouldn't mind if you address it from a banker's standpoint, what you look for financial information.
The formatting, I guess, just clarify the formatting comment is right on, but it doesn't mean just reshuffling numbers on the spreadsheet. What it really means is having a clarity on the basic information that we always ask for, is last 3 years of tax returns, whatever they may be, even if there's just internally prepared financial statements for the business, and we want to see the cash flow, profit and loss statement, balance sheet, depending on the type of business. I mean, those are the basics. That's to start with. And what we're finding that frequently the small businesses, they don't have a clear internal financial record keeping. So it takes the lender a tremendous amount of time to try to unwind it, and then you get to right to the end and then you discover, oh, I forgot I had this thing on my credit, or I forgot I had this loan, or I forgot about this, and it's not showing up. And it, that process starts all over because the financial picture looks very different. So having all that up front, having it all collected, having a clear picture, and go back to the five C's of lending. So the credit, that's your credit score. It's not the only credits. That's not necessarily what the credit score is. What's on the credit report, right? So the lender can then project what your cash flow is going to be. As a sole proprietor or LLC, it's all consolidated. The only other thing I would mention is there are some, we've hosted some sessions at Optus Bank too, about business credit. Business credit. Most banks, community banks, don't look at business credit at all. They look at it consolidated because you're personally guaranteeing the debt. So we want to see the full financial picture of the borrower. Can that borrower have some, I guess, vision to repaying the debt? And with the, that's where the SBA comes in. If it's not guaranteed cash flow that's already generating, the SBA, using the SBA credit enhancements, which we use frequently, they allow us to base that loan decision on projections because we have that credit enhancement that Greg and his team provides.
And I'm glad the bankers are very realistic. So if you come through with inflated figures and it looks like that's not realistic, they will push you aside and go somewhere else.
And if I could add one thing to that, Greg. So you're all sitting there listening, and Dom is exactly right. But if I were you sitting out there, I'd probably be saying, well, what does that look like? And how do I get from here to there with that package? And that's where we can sit down with you, with one of our experts, and go through it step by step. We're not going to put it all together for you. We're going to guide you through it because you need to understand it. When you present that to the bank, you're the one that has to sit in front of the banker and explain what those numbers mean and how you put them together. So we're going to educate you while we guide you through putting that package together.
That's great. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. My name is Lynn Hutto, and I've worked with many of the people in the room. I help to manage the Columbia Chambers. I'm going to give a shameless plug here. The Columbia Chambers Minority Business Accelerator Program. And many of the people in the room and on the stage, if one of their people, if they're not involved directly, they have some of their employees involved. And what we do is we teach businesses how to scale. And with that, I'd like to just say to many of the businesses here, we teach you how to work on your business and not in your business. And I think somebody said earlier that so often we're so busy trying to run our business, we can't look up and see what's going on around us. And so it's very important that you take the time to come to these kind of opportunities. You get, when they say free guys, free is free, okay? And you really need to take advantage of it because these guys have years and years of expertise. Many of their people, we have, this program has coaching element worked into it where we assign a business coach and a financial coach. It's a year-long program. It asks you to make a serious commitment, but when you come out on the other end, and you see some of the businesses that have been through our program, you'll see that it's well worth the investment. It's not free, but when you look at what you get, it is a $15,000 program. It's a year-long program. When you come out on the other end, many of the things, especially the financials, it is a program where we get transparent. We just pull it all off and let people see. You have to be vulnerable. And if you're not, if you can't share your problems with these people and other people who are trying to help you, they're not trying to shame you, they're not trying to make you feel bad. You got to take it off and let them see what it is so they can help you. So this is what our program is all about. It's not for startups, because one of the things that we found is some of the businesses that have been in business for a long time need to almost start over from a structural standpoint. And so we help them do that. And again, we couldn't do it without the assistance of the mayor and everybody in this room, SBA, great. I think you've come and talked to us at our program. Guys, if not our program, find one. They're excellent. Find people that really care about making sure our businesses in our community survive and thrive and can offer opportunities for others.
Lynn, can you tell everybody what they actually pay? Because they don't pay $15,000.
No, I'm sorry. You don't pay $15,000. One of the things that you thank you,
but you accept donations. You accept donations.
From the chamber, it's a nonprofit organization. But one of the things that we ask, you have to be a member of the chamber. That's a given. But with that comes so many opportunities to actually interact with the mayor and the city council, county council, and other big businesses that are coming into this community who are looking to partner with some of you all, okay? So you join the chamber membership, I think it's about $600, and then you also pay a $500 fee. And the reason why we do that is because we found that if you don't have skin in the game sometimes, you're not gonna give it the attention and the value that it needs. So when you think about a program that's $15,000, and all we're asking you to do is to make a minimum investment of $1,100, and then your time. You have to be committed, because the people who are coaching you, we're not paying them, they're volunteering. Many of these guys volunteer their time. And when I say coach, somebody who's gonna walk with you through the program. So that $1,100 is a drop in the bucket compared to what you get in the program.
Echo that. We have similar programs through SBA called Thrive.
Yes.
We don't have it in Columbia, we've got an agreement in Charleston, but it's a very similar program, and it helps you grow your business.
And can I add, we also have a program when we get businesses who apply and they're not ready for this program, we have what they call entrepreneur pathways. We work with Michelle and her folks who actually start, kind of walk you through some of the same processes so that you'll be ready for our program in the next year's upcoming year.
Thank you. Okay, I've got some other questions from some businesses here.
So it's kind of a piggyback off of his question and the young lady's question about the nonprofit. Can you hear me? Yes? Oh, okay. So I know with a nonprofit, it kind of runs almost like a for-profit as far as the financials and some of the business structure. I know that you say that you don't offer like programs financially to kind of help those nonprofits, but do you offer like the learning that's needed to help kind of structure the business of the nonprofit?
I was going to say yes, because you're right. A lot of the topics that we'll discuss, such as marketing, the financial infrastructure, would apply for anyone operating any type of organization. The only limits would be the financial assistance. Our office in the City of Columbia can do that. But I'm oftentimes doing research to see what opportunities exist for funding. So I would still encourage nonprofits to reach out to our organization and get in our network so you are able to network with others when we have different events and workshop opportunities.
I will tell you that our SCORE chapters, they will help assist small businesses, their nonprofits, grow and get organized, and also help them with their growth.
If I can add to that as well, so we work with a lot of nonprofits at Optus Bank, and to us, your taxes and status doesn't matter to us whether you're tax exempt or not. You're still a small business, and nonprofits are a critical part of our small business infrastructure in our state and our country. So we finance facilities for nonprofits, we finance office buildings, we finance or even advanced working capital when they have grants that are coming in, but it's mismatched with their cash flow needs. So many of the financial institutions we work with nonprofits, we just treat it just like regular business. It has to pass the same underwriting criteria as a regular business.
But it's a little harsher for
any questions? Another question? Yes, ma'am. We'll catch you first. There's a question. There's another question right here.
Just to give you a resource on nonprofits, if you're going to be seeking federal funding, federal grants, you're going to need a SAM registration. So you're still going to have to come see APEX. And we have a lot of resources that the DOD is allowing us to supply to for-profit organizations. And I have researched several grant opportunities, especially if you're in innovation, research and development. That's now a new task under our new leadership for the DOD that we help with grant opportunities. So because you're going to need SAM, you're going to still be coming to see us at APEC. So again, by all means, all of these resource partners, we're just all here to help you. So coming from the federal side, we kind of get that and a little bit of it all.
Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is LaShawn Anderson. I am a nurse, and I'm in the process of opening up my healthcare agency. So I had a question about licensure. What type of license will I need to get started?
So you definitely need a business license, but it goes off of your NAICS, which is your industry classification. So that would determine your rate for your license. But you definitely need to come in and get that. Is it going to be a physical location business, or is it going to be like a home occupation?
Home occupation.
Okay, so then we would have you fill out a home occupation form for zoning as well.
Okay.
Other questions?
Is there a sheet with all these acronyms that are
an acronym person. Which one would you like to know? SBDC is Small Business Development Center. SCORE is, used to be Service Corps of Retired Executives. So that's some of them we're talking about.
Apex.
They're the federal contract entity, so that's what you want. Federal contract, no doubt. Yes, sir. Way back in the back. One question.
So to piggyback on her question about licensing, she would need a license city, but also a license for the county, correct? Depending on if she's in Richland County.
Correct. I'm sorry. Yeah, correct. And in some cases, if, because the city sits in the county, depending upon your NAICS code, it may be a situation where you're coming to Richland County where you may have to get, you'll have your city license, but there will be a personal assessment that you'll have to do with the county, and it might not necessarily require you to have that. So anytime it's great that you check with both the city and the county, because we found people where they needed both.
And you also can make sure you have emergency license.
Oh,
that,
for sure.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I just wanted to add one thing. If I could go back when I started my business, started working on with government contracting and state and federal contracts. And there's one thing that I would share with you guys that I want you to take away is when you start your business, make sure you hone in on what you do well. Sometimes we get these, you say, I don't have to do this and I can do that. Well, my NAICS code is facility maintenance, right? And construction. They kind of go together, right? But then if I add event planning, then what is my past performance in event planning? Sometimes when we get in business, we start saying, oh, I can do this and I can do that. Well, you're limiting your ability for success and to get contracts because they're going to look for your past performance. They're going to look for your experience and make sure that you can be successful in being able to perform on the contract. So that's what I would share with you.
Thanks, Vicki.
Can I ask you a question about that?
Sure.
When you started your business, were you sole ownership?
I am still today.
Okay, so if you had someone for that past performance that could have helped you, and then that 49% business owner, how would that have affected you for your 8A?
So with the 8A, as long as you're in the correct form, 51% ownership, right? So as long as you're still 51% ownership, right? And then we have self-performance requirements. So I had to perform a certain amount of the work myself, and each NAICS code have a certain amount that you have to perform self-performance within your team.
Right, and so the question would be, are the, I know that there are personal and value assessments for the owners of the company. So if the owner of the company net worth is X and then the 49% person is Y, is that a problem?
So I didn't encounter that because I'm 100% owner.
Well, I'm 100% too, but I'm thinking that maybe to break that gap, that my project manager, I could give a ownership. hardship to him, but you know, his network may be a lot more than that. Is that going to monkey with that?
That's something we'll have to look at on a case-by-case basis.
We need to get you concerned at least.
Yeah, we'll get you set up. One more question. Oh, that one right here.
So what am I, I'm very new to this, and I'm still actually learning the vocabulary, and there's quite a few acronyms I've learned today.
I
know I need to talk with Ms. Kelly Smith, definitely, and I'm also a nurse looking to set up like a home-based kind of thing. What's kind of, I do need like some training, and there's no shortage of consultants that are trying to get my money to help, you know, with this training and that training and setting up a business in that particular field. But what's holding me back is my understanding that I don't want to have a very limited income capital right now. And before I start putting it into this business, my understanding is I need to have that business license in place so that I'll be able, is that like the first step, so that I'll be able to write off all of these things that I put in for the training and the different certifications or whatever that I decide to get in order to be, you know, have that credibility in the field.
Michelle, you want to thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. You want to start there with business licensing, just to make sure that you're a licensed business and you're in compliance. So I would recommend starting there first, but as far as getting any type of consulting and things like that, you may want to go this
way. We do a lot of investing.
Yeah, so the chief, I would start there, but if you'll come make an appointment, come sit down with one of our folks, we can walk you through step by step in kind of chronological order. What do I need to do to get everything in place?
That's a very, very good resource. Yes, sir.
Being here for 44, about 44 years, I've seen this thing with all you guys and kids. And of course, South Carolina is changing. I was here when it wasn't. My own nose, aerospace. Telecommunications engineering from the state. Been here for 44 years. State Water Network, been there, still there. We started an engineering firm because of the battles that I incurred in trying to grow in Columbia. I opened up an engineering firm in Charlotte. And it has to be a working relationship. You may have the institution, but you have to have the people that really have the aptitude to see the progressiveness that you have for the firm to grow. Joining and basically participating in the energy field. All right? And a great number of friends of mine actually did all the energy systems for BMW, all my partners. And we still see, like for instance, the Scout truck coming here, right? Richland County had a lot to do with getting the Scout company here. What are y'all doing to make sure that those participants in that program up there is actually getting some work from people right here in the right back door? Now, there's a lot happening over there. Railroads being moved in, plants are being built, teams are already formed without both participation.
Maybe, Dave, you want to address that with what's happening as far as Scout firm?
Or anybody up here?
I'm going to defer to the county because they actually set up vendor days and have put in the program.
That'd be great.
Specifics about making sure local businesses.
So there are a couple of moving parts with Scout. I will say that we did partner with Commerce a few weeks ago in that we were able to get roughly 600 businesses in front of procurement professionals with Scout. Okay, so that was one piece. There's also some legislative folks that are involved as far as making sure that there is participation in a few different areas that they're going to be using small businesses that are within the region as well. What I am going to suggest is, number one, that you and I talk offline about a few things, but I can say that from a county council perspective, I know that there have been several meetings with Scout. The onus of small businesses being involved has been expressed not only locally, but also with commerce and commerce being used as part of the vehicle.
Exactly.
And having the portal and all that, to make sure that there, we're capturing the businesses that are available here to do business with Scout. So there will be some ongoing efforts as we partner also with economic development with what will be happening with Scout.
Right now, pre-construction is happening out there right now, and everybody knows that pre-construction leads into pretty much relationships that builds the plan. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. We're going to wrap it up. I'm going to ask the mayor and Alec Kellogg to close this with some closing comments.